Can I just take this moment to remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place, and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus. The next item of business is a debate on motion 2553 in the name of Jamie Green on ending the not proven verdict. And can I ask members who wish to participate in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Jamie Green to speak to and move the motion, up to 7 minutes, Mr Green.
So I'll be on the front bench.
You are quite right, there is no one on the front bench. Oh, thank you. Okay, please begin, Mr Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased and privileged to use our precious commodity of opposition business to bring forward this debate today. Apologies, may I continue, members? This is an important debate. I do so in the context that tomorrow I'm also launching the consultation for my own members' bill, the Victims, Criminal Justice and Fatal Accident Inquiries Scotland Bill. Not the catchiest of title, but contained in that bill, therein are a number of sensible proposals which seek to strengthen the rights of victims in Scotland. Victims. To empower them in decisions that affect their daily lives, to grant them wider access to information which they should already be given freely, to make them feel safer by ensuring that dangerous criminals stay away from them, their homes and their families. So, and also, none of the above should be controversial. None of the above should seem unreasonable to us as a Parliament. I'd go as far as saying that improving the rights of victims of crime should be wholly incontrovertible and not even require a member's bill in the first place. But we are where we are. And I would say that when the consultation is published tomorrow, I will ask members, the government, stakeholders and the wider public to please look carefully at my proposals and respond with their views and opinions. But there is another part to my bill which forms the basis of my motion today, and that is our call to end the three verdict outcome in Scottish courts through the removal of the not proven verdict. And we do so unapologetically. It is an explicit promise in our manifesto. It is an issue that we've led the way on, and it is an issue which we now want Parliament to finally take a stand on. And frankly, I cannot see why we wouldn't want to. Of course, there is opposition to this out there. Change is not always welcome, and change is not always easy. This will be the most profound overhaul of the justice system in 300 years. But we are not alone in this position. Every party went into the Scottish election promising action. This is not a new debate either, which makes my very point. We have been having this debate for years, for decades, actually for centuries, as far back as 1846, when the system was criticised, or as most recently as 2013, when this last Parliament considered a private member's bill to abolish the verdict. Now, back then, Christine Graham, who was the then convener of the Justice Committee, 9 years ago, said, "The not proven verdict is often deeply unsatisfactory for victims and is often no better for the accused. Like many members of the committee, I believe that the not proven verdict is on borrowed time." Well, colleagues, I think its time has run out, and now we must act. But more importantly, and I think happily.
Christine Graham.
Delighted you're trolling the archives for my words of wisdom, but also at the time you'll recall I opposed the abolition of corroboration because all these things, not proven, corroboration, size of jury, a majority or a unanimous verdict are all interlinked, so it's a very complex issue.
Jamie Green.
And I'm glad the member raises that, and I'm going to come on to that explicitly in my comments today. I hope there is consensus in the Chamber to act, because there is consensus, I think, that the current free verdict system is simply not fit for purpose. No least for the victims of the sort of crimes that we often talk about in this chamber. Women and girls, mostly, who suffer at the hands of gender-based violence, of domestic abuse, of rape and sexual assault. The very people that we so often make promises to. Well, we're very good at talking the talk when it comes to those promises. But now it's time to walk the walk. Starting off, so there must be over 60,000 criminal cases in our backlogged courts, a number that is growing by the day. More than 70% of trials in the High Court relate to serious sexual offences. We know that the prosecution rate of rape trials is abnormally and unacceptably low. Last year, from over 2,000 reported incidents, only 130 were successfully prosecuted. We also know that 30% of acquittals in rape trials were down to not proven verdicts, compared to just 17% for all crimes and offences. There clearly is an imbalance here which must be addressed. That is my view, and that is also the view of the victims of crimes themselves, many of whom are left utterly confused, perplexed, bewildered and even angry after a not proven verdict. Equally, it leaves a cloud, a shadow of doubt over those who do walk free, those who have been found to neither be guilty nor not guilty. It was put by Professor James Chalmers as a verdict which stigmatises the accused, operated by a nudge and a wink, carrying a meaning which no one is willing to articulate. I make the case today that if the accused is not guilty, then they deserve to be labelled as such. And our proposition is widely backed by those on the front line helping victims of crime. Scottish Women's Aid, the Scottish Women's Rights Centre and Rape Crisis Scotland, who publicly stated that there are real worries that the existence of the not proven verdict gives juries in rape trials an easy out and contributes to guilty people walking free. The First Minister herself was very clear on not proven. She said that there was mounting evidence and an increasingly strong arguments that the not proven verdict is part of that low conviction rate. Hamza Youssef, the then Justice Secretary, said that the research was absolutely clear that the not proven verdict causes confusion for many jurors and causes significant distress. I don't disagree with him. I don't disagree with the First Minister. I don't disagree with Lorna Slater, who said that this ambiguous third option is confusing and unfair on both complainers and the accused. And its time needs to end. Well, its time does need to end, and that's why I'm asking all of them. That's why I'm asking each member today to demonstrate that we mean what we say. The thing that we promised in our manifestos, we will deliver on it. Now, I do accept to address the point that not proven in its own right, it cannot be changed in isolation. The interconnectivity between corroboration, between the size of juries, between majority verdicts of juryless trials or dedicated specialist courts, they're all live issues, they're all connected issues, and they're all important issues. But neither should they act as barriers to change or reasons to delay. Just because it has always been that way doesn't mean it should always be that way. In my view, the question we should be asking is, what do we need to change in our trials or our courts or our juries to facilitate that move? The what, not the if. And in doing so, we should make those voices of dissent part of the solution to the change, not the opposition to it. At the end of the day, Presiding Officer, sometimes we need to make difficult decisions. We often say this has been rumbling on for years. Well, this has been rumbling on for years. I'm asking members to set aside their prejudices or views on the motion. I'm asking them not to kick this further into the long grass, because that's simply not an option. Doing nothing is not an option. Delay is not an option. And by voting for my motion, we can and we will send a strong message to those victims of crime that we as a Parliament are willing to act, and act now, because act we must. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Keith Brown to speak to and move Amendment 2553.3, up to 6 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President. So just to be clear at the start, I move the amendment in my name. I'll be supporting the amendment submitted by the Labour Party also. Will not be supporting the motion from Jamie Green. I should say as well at the outset, so as he did mention the bill that he intends to bring forward, I will look at that bill genuinely to see if there's further things that we can do. He is right to say we should continually try to improve how victim-centred the scheme of justice that we have is. It is my view that much of what I know, and I don't know all, of the bill are things which we already currently do, or maybe replicate some things which are in train, but I will look at that bill in good faith. The Scottish legal system has evolved substantially over the centuries, and it is vital that we ensure that the justice system itself develops in response to new evidence and in line with the values of the people of Scotland. Jamie Green rightly said that he was following through in a manifesto commitment, and that's exactly what I'm doing when I say we will consult on this. That's what we said we would do. He is right to have quoted the First Minister, who said there's a strong case to look at this again, and I reflect and agree with those sentiments. But our commitment is to consult on this. Juries have played a crucial role in the Scottish criminal justice system for hundreds of years, and I'm grateful to those who have carried out this important public duty by serving on them. It is, though, important that we reflect on the findings of the independent jury research published in 2019, something that was not available during earlier considerations, again, which Jamie Green refers to by this Parliament and by other parties. But that was the largest, most realistic of its kind ever undertaken in the UK, and it considered the unique Scottish jury system with 15 jurors, 3 verdicts, including not proven, and a simple majority. And those things are inextricably interlinked. The research highlighted inconsistent views on the meaning and effect of the not proven verdict and how it differs from not guilty. It's also vital that we involve the public and stakeholders in these discussions. That's why, after the report's publication, we held events across the country with legal professionals, third sector and survivors. I've had a number of conversations myself, which I know Jamie Green and others have had as well, with survivors, where concerns were raised regarding the not proven verdict, such as lack of understanding, perceived stigma and the trauma that the verdict can cause. I am also, of course, aware that more recently the third verdict has been criticised due to the higher rates of not proven acquittals for rape and attempted rape cases, and some campaigners have suggested that the existence of the third verdict may contribute to the acquittal of defendants who committed the offence and causes particular trauma to victims. I take the views of survivors very seriously. I have spoken to them directly, as I say. Furthermore, in our programme for government, we have committed to giving serious consideration to the recommendations of the Lord Justice Clerk's review on improving the management of sexual offence cases. This report has the potential to drive transformational change across the system beyond sexual offence cases. However, there are complex issues, and many other stakeholders have made their views clear that the third verdict should be retained, or highlighted the interconnectedness, as I have tried to do, of the system, emphasising that the 3 verdicts, simple majority required for conviction and the size of the jury, are so interrelated that it would not be possible to meaningfully assess these factors separately from one another. Others argue that the corroboration rule, requiring that there is more than a single source of evidence, should also be part of this consideration. Earlier this year, over 1,000 Scottish qualified solicitors took part in an online survey in response to the question of what the legal profession thinks about the current 3-verdict criminal justice system in Scotland. Over 70% of those who responded to the survey said they believed that the not-proven verdict should be retained, primarily due to their view that it provides an important safeguard to prevent wrongful convictions. I will do.
Jamie Green.
The Cabinet Secretary seems to be going to great lengths to excuse the status quo. The Cabinet Secretary is the 4th Justice Secretary who has promised action on this. What comfort can you give the victims of crime that this government will finally take that action that it promised them?
Cabinet Secretary.
I have to say, I think it's really wrong for Jamie Green to characterise what I've said up to this point as defending the status quo. I'm laying out the reasons why we are consulting on this. And in consulting on it, I'm doing what my party said it would do when we won the election a few months ago. He is right to pursue his manifesto. I'm pursuing mine. It's not a surprise to anybody that we would do it in this way. And it's also my view that I've just mentioned 70% of those lawyers who were polled were for retaining it. I think it's right, even if I wasn't to agree with them, that we should consult with the legal profession as we go forward with what he has rightly said is one of the biggest changes to the legal framework in many years. So we are doing what we said we would do. Furthermore, we also have to be mindful that the not proven verdict affects all cases, not just sexual offences. In 2019-20, there were 1,039 not proven verdicts, and the majority of these verdicts were for crimes that were not sexual in nature. Presiding Officer, I believe that we can't simply disregard the complexity. I think the implication of the motion in front of us is that we go straight to abolishing not proven, regardless of the other things which are related to it within the system. And I don't support that. I think we have to consider these things together. And I think we also have to take into account the opposing views, some of which I set out just now. Although I've been very clear that I do have serious concerns with the not proven verdict, and that is not a justification of the status quo. There is clearly a breadth of informed principle opinion on this matter, and we owe all in the justice system to robustly consider and, where appropriate, challenge those views. What's needed is an holistic, evidence-based approach that addresses the whole system, as well as considering wider potential reforms, such as those which I mentioned from the Lord Justice Clerk's review, rather than rushing to action without pausing to think through the consequences for the rest of the system. That's why earlier this week the Scottish Government launched a consultation on these interrelated matters, and I would encourage all those with an interest to consider and respond in due course. As I've said, others argue that the corroboration rule requiring the one single source of evidence should also be looked at. And these are important matters which many members, whether it's the Law Society, whether it's the Faculty of Advocates, where people have very serious views. And it seems to me only right, if we want to have a sustainable change, a major change to the system, it's only right that we consult with those that are most directly involved in administering the system, as well as those that are affected by it. So for that reason, I would ask the Parliament to support the motion, sorry, the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Katie Clark to speak to and move Amendment 2553.1. Up to 5 minutes, Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I warmly welcome this debate and move the amendment put down in the name of Polly McNeill, which recognises that many survivors of sexual crimes find their experiences of the justice system to be re-traumatising, believes that improving the experience of women and girls requires changes throughout the justice system, and recognises that the current backlog of cases disproportionately impacts on women and girls. Whilst over the last decade the figures for most crimes in Scotland have fallen, those for sexual offences continue to rise. That might be because more women are reporting offences, or it may be that the overall levels of sexual violence are increasing. In the year 2019-20, the last year that we have figures, 44% of rape and attempted rape cases resulted in a not proven verdict. This suggests that there was evidence, but the jury felt that it did not meet the beyond reasonable doubt threshold. And of course, in many cases, many rape cases, it is whether there was consent which is the main issue at trial. There can be no doubt that society's attitudes towards women and girls impact on the decisions that juries take. Lady Dorrian's report looked at this issue and suggested better training and support for juries. Trials without juries have even been suggested, as well as a range of other changes, including the introduction of specialist courts. On behalf of the Labour Party, I say that the justice system needs to be more responsive to survivors' experiences, and that includes the police and the courts. There is agreement across the political parties represented in this Parliament about much of what needs to be done, but the policy as outlined by government and the authorities is very different from the testimony we hear from survivors who continue to describe their experiences of a justice system which they feel fails them, that they find to be traumatic, and which does not work for them. The Criminal Justice Committee has met with survivors, some of whom still have cases going through the system, and it's clear that they feel that the justice system continues to fail women. We need a justice system where staff dealing with cases in every part of that system are trained in trauma-informed approaches, and problematic attitudes towards sexual violence need to be addressed in all parts of the justice system, including in the courts and the police service, through education and changing the way that we deal with cases. So it is clear that a range of measures need to be taken to deliver the justice system that victims of crime often feel that they are denied. The Lord Advocate has said that in cases of sexual violence that make up 70% of the workload of the High Court, and that has increased dramatically over the decades. And of that 70%, 80 to 85% of those cases go to trial. So the current backlog disproportionately involves women and girls as victims of crime. We need to look at how we deal with those cases more quickly, and whether there are changes that could be brought in, perhaps as pilots, which could speed up how those cases are brought to conclusion as speedily as possible. I welcome the debate that's been brought today by the Conservative Party and it looking at the not proven verdict as part of a wide range of changes that need to be made to the legal system. Our legal system should have criminal laws which reflect the values of the society we aim to have. We have a justice system which continues to work in the interests of male perpetrators of violence and against the interests of women and girls. and in relation to other cases also, the interests of victims are not in the centre in the way that really I believe we would all want. So I welcome that we are debating these issues today. I look forward to the debate. There's previously been a private member's bill on this issue, and I know that we'll be looking at this issue again, and I welcome that the government have come forward with a consultation to look in particular at the not proven verdict so that all voices can be heard before legislation is brought to this chamber.
Thank you. I now call Liam MacArthur. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Can I too pay tribute to campaigner Speak Out Survivors, Miss Emma and others, for the courage, candour and their commitment to change, to deliver the improvements in our justice system in the way that it deals with the heinous crimes of sexual violence and rape against the backdrop of what is happening in the way that Katie Clark just rightly described. This has been the subject of cross-party discussions through the course of the last Parliament and during the early months of this Parliament. I would like to thank colleagues across the Parliament, as well as the current and the previous Justice Secretary, for the collaborative approach that I think that has been taken on this issue. But those discussions have been informal, they've been behind the scenes, and I think it's right that we have an opportunity now to debate this in a more public sense. In that sense, I thank Jamie Green for providing that opportunity. His motion perhaps jumps the gun, but it points, I think, to the right direction of travel. We will, however, support the Government's amendment, as well as Polly McNeill's amendment, which makes the important argument around the risks of re-traumatising victims. Scottish Liberal Democrats have, I think for some time now, been sympathetic to calls for the not proven verdict to be dropped. It doesn't really sit well in a modern legal context, not least because there's no fixed legal definition of this verdict, which was established through custom and precedent in the Scottish courts in the 17th and 18th centuries. We know from the 2019 research that the Cabinet Secretary referred to that it can be confusing for juries, leading to higher rates of acquittal, as Humza Yousaf had previously acknowledged. It's confusing for the public too, of the often stigmatising an accused person by appearing not to clear them of charges, and it routinely fails to provide closure for victims. So the case for change, I think, is strong, if not compelling. But I think we do a disservice to those campaigning for change, to those tasked with enforcing our laws and our legal system itself, if we ignore or downplay the complexities or the interconnections that I think have been acknowledged this afternoon. I note the Law Society briefing, for example, points to those concerns raised across the profession, even amongst actually some of those who are supportive of a move to two verdicts from three. So it's important we understand these concerns, we reflect on them, and we seek as far as possible to address them. So I do welcome the launch of the consultation over the last few days. It is, I think, a chance to consider a range of views, including opponents, but crucially also victims and those with lived experience. It will need to look too, I think, not just at the not proven verdict, as Christine Graham rightly highlighted in her intervention. It needs to look at the size and the makeup of juries, as well as the majorities needed to convict. The right for legal anonymity for victims in sexual offence prosecutions, which exists in other parts of the UK, doesn't exist here, notwithstanding, I think, the steps that are often taken by courts to protect that anonymity. And look again at corroboration, although I do hope that lessons have been learnt and the Scottish Government will not seek to rerun battles through the abolition of corroboration. And importantly, more to protect victims from being re-traumatised by the justice system that is supposed to be there to protect them. And as I say, I think that was very well picked up in Polly McNeill's amendment. Lord Carlaway stated recently that cross-examination should not be used as a means of intimidating or humiliating witnesses. And he's absolutely right. So, Presiding Officer, there is a great deal of common ground in this area. I hope we can continue in that vein, while also having the necessary challenge function as we pursue the improvements we all believe are required. I thank Jamie Green again for enabling this debate, if not perhaps for wanting to bypass the consultative process needed before we arrive at an end point, which I sense has a growing inevitability about it. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. We now move to open debate speeches, and I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 3 weeks ago, this chamber stood united to condemn violence against women. We remembered women who had their lives cut tragically short, and we made a promise to improve the safety and well-being of women here in Scotland. During this debate, I mentioned that we need to legislate better to eliminate violence against women. One way of doing this would be to end the not proven verdict, as it is commonly used in sexual crime, particularly in cases of rape. The ending of the not proven verdict has been supported by several women's rights organisations, including Rape Crisis Scotland, and their position is clear. This court ruling must go. During the SNP's time in government, the number of sexual crimes has more than doubled. The conviction rate for rape currently stands at 46.1%, which is lower than other crimes. In 2019-2020, the not proven verdict was used as an equal acquittal verdict 74 times in rape and attempted rape cases. This makes up 44% of acquittal verdicts issued in the 300 cases preceded to court in Scotland. These statistics prove that women are disproportionately impacted by the not proven verdict, and it is why the Scottish Conservatives are committed to ending this through our victims' law. The Scottish Conservatives first called for the abolition of the not proven verdict more than a year ago. In 2019, Equally Safe, Scotland's strategy to eradicate violence against women was published, and it contained a commitment to undertake research into jury decision making to improve understanding of factors that influence juries' decisions in solemn criminal crime cases. That was almost 3 years ago, yet it was only announced a few days ago that consultation was finally getting underway. Similarly, the Scottish Greens have also called for this to be scrapped within their 2021 manifesto. So why the delay? Should the Scottish Government continue to dither over the scrapping of the not proven verdict, more women could be continued to be failed by the justice system. I've only got 4 minutes, sorry, I'd like to make some progress. We can't continue to ignore a justice system which favours the perpetrator over the victim. If we do, then the words that we all spoke 3 weeks ago were for nothing and will have achieved nothing. Today, women and girls are more confident in reporting incidents. Sadly, low conviction rates and the incidence of a not proven verdict jeopardise the confidence of women and girls and could lead to less attacks being reported to begin with. The conviction must be aligned to support women and girls. Presiding Officer, we also need to go further than to end the not proven verdict. We need other laws such as Michelle's Law and Suzanne's Law to be fully implemented to support victims and their families. The Scottish Conservatives have been pushing for better legislation to support victims, and the Scottish Government must realise that the current justice system is not fit for purpose. Looking at the amendments today, it is clear that political parties are not worlds apart when looking at ending the not proven verdict, but progress has been at a snail's pace. I understand that the justice system is complex and it is an interrelated system, and I also realise the Scottish Government's desire for a consultation. But I think we need to realise as well that many are frustrated by the length of time it's taken for the Scottish Government to take this seriously. After all, if you are a woman and have been subjected to a heinous crime such as rape, I can understand why at present they may feel that the justice system will not allow for them to have closure free of stigma should the verdict be viewed as not proven. Yes. Presiding Officer, I look forward to the day where women and girls feel that the justice system works for them, not against them. Ending the not proven verdict is the right thing to do and is an important step towards stronger legislation that protects women and girls. I am sure MSPs of all parties in this chamber will support that objective. Thank you.
Thank you. I call John Mason to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think, like Martin Whitfield, I am a late substitute to this debate. So we'll see how we get on. So we have the three verdicts, and the suggestion is that we move to two. And that clearly would be simpler and would be more clear-cut than the present system. And I very much welcome the consultation by the government. It is clearly a more complex question than some are suggesting. Amongst other points to be considered, as we've already heard, are the size of the jury, the majority required, and corroboration, as Christine Graham was pointing out earlier. And I would also agree with quite a lot in the Conservative motion and in what Jamie Green himself said, apart from just the last few words of the motion. We want to improve the system. We want to give women who have been victims of rape or other violence a better result. Therefore, the question for me is, what if we're moving from three verdicts to two, what should the two verdicts be? Now, the main suggestion is clearly that we should drop not proven, but I would suggest that is not the only option. And I would just want to suggest that we should consider that the two options could potentially be proven and not proven. So if the choice is whether we keep not guilty or we keep not proven, which is better? Which is the more honest result? As I understand it, the question for the jury is whether the Crown has or has not proved or proven its case. Beyond reasonable doubt, as Christine Graham reminds me. So, for example, the accused might actually be innocent, or the accused might be guilty, but the Crown has failed to prove its case. In that kind of situation, is it really right or honest to say that that person is not guilty, or is it actually better and more honest to say that the case is not proven? Now, I understand there is some support amongst legal professionals for such a proven and not proven a couple of verdicts. But I also accept that this is currently a minority view and the trend is to drop not proven. So my purpose is really just to ask that all of these options be considered and we do not immediately jump to conclusions as to which verdict should be dropped. So again, I just welcome the consultation and I encourage as many people as possible to take part in it. I hope the government, I hope Jamie Green and the opposition, and in fact the whole Parliament, it will listen to the responses that come in with genuinely open minds. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I give this speech on behalf of my colleague Claire Baker, MSP, who is unable to contribute it herself due to technical difficulties. And can I take this opportunity to thank you, Presiding Officer, and to this chamber for its indulgence. I'm pleased to contribute to this afternoon's debate. While the motion is focused on the removal of the not proven verdict, a position I have previously supported, as my former colleague Michael McCone pursued a member's bill on this matter, it does allow for some broader reflection on related issues. The arguments brought forward for removing the not proven verdict in 2016 remain today. Rape Crisis Scotland state that almost a quarter of trials for rape or attempted rape result in a not proven verdict. It is shown to be disproportionately used in rape and attempted rape cases. In 2019 to 2020, 44% of acquittals in rape or attempted rape were not proven, and that is in comparison to 20% for overall crimes. There is evidence that juries find the verdict confusing. There is the misunderstanding that it is in some way different from not guilty, that it provides a third verdict. Rape Crisis Scotland have described it as an easy out for juries, which results in guilty people walking free. This also results in those who receive the verdict still being regarded with suspicion, as though they have some way evaded the jury. And I welcome the consultation, but given it is some 5 years since the Justice Committee's work on the previous bill, we can anticipate the debate and positions that are likely to take place. At that time, the Justice Committee described the verdict as living on borrowed time. Conclude the consultation, but the government must realise that change here is also requires leadership, and there is a parliamentary consensus and indeed manifesto commitments to deliver on this. But I don't underestimate how difficult it is. The briefing from the Law Society reminds us of the principles of our system, the presumption of innocence, respecting the rights of all involved, minimising the risk of wrongful convictions. However, in cases of rape and attempted rape, I would argue there is an imbalance which fails women and girls and indeed denies them justice. In Scotland, only 43% of rape and attempted rape result in a conviction, compared to the overall conviction rate of 88%, a figure which is more than double the level of successful convictions for rape and attempted rape. In 2019 and 20, there were 2,343 rapes and reported rapes, reported to the police. And remember, we know that this is an underreported crime, but there were only 300 prosecutions and just 130 convictions. This is surely not acceptable. This is a crime which is overwhelmingly committed against women by men, a crime which causes extreme distress and trauma, which can have long-lasting effects on people. Yet it is so difficult to prosecute. And even when it is difficult to convict. This is a crime which is often not even recognised as a crime and is one where, for the perpetrator, there is a reasonable likelihood of no consequences. We have seen cases where women take the case to the civil courts in order to gain justice and have the offence, indeed the crime, acknowledged. It is not the appropriate route for the severity of this crime. I have previously raised concerns following the case of Denise Clare, who bravely waived her anonymity to speak about her experience that women would resort to civil courts. In 2018, Ms M successfully sued Stephen Coxon in a Scottish civil court, with the sheriff saying the evidence against Coxon was compelling and persuasive. And this was following a not proven verdict in 2016, and is the first time someone has been cleared in a criminal trial but then subsequently sued. Much is made of the lesser burden of the proof.
The member is now over time and yes. Concluding.
My apologies. Much is made of the lesser burden of proof in civil cases, but if we look at Lady Dorrien's report into justice responses into sexual crimes, the way in which juries hear rape cases is examined. I recognise the arguments made for reforming corroboration in Scots law. It presents a barrier to conviction in sexual assault cases. But we should recognise 300 cases that did not reach trial in
Scotland. Please conclude, Mr Whitfield.
I'm grateful, Presiding Officer. Under the current system, there is no evidence to support that more cases going to court will result in a higher conviction
rate. Thank you, Mr Whitfield.
More people must experience trauma but achieve no conviction.
Thank you. I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by saying that I do understand why the member has brought this motion here today on behalf of his party. He's on the Justice Committee with me, and he's heard firsthand the heartbreaking evidence from witnesses of how they feel they have been failed, sometimes even re-traumatised by the justice system in relation to these type of cases. However, there can also be no doubt that today's motion is nothing more than simple politicking because of that. Because the member knows, as other members have mentioned, the Scottish Government is currently reviewing the not proven verdict. He and I both know, as members of the Justice Committee, that there is a genuine and cross-party commitment to ensuring that Scotland's justice system is fair, transparent and meets the needs of modern society. The three-verdict legal system, which is quite unique to Scotland, has long been divisive, and we all have our own personal views on it. And I likely share the same sentiments as Mr Green, Ms Gallagher and others who have spoken today in the Tory benches. However, he also knows that a legal system is very complex, and we must think carefully about what to do and not actually make the situation worse for complainers, a fear that has been articulated by Rape Crisis Scotland. The detailed and extensive consultation launched will do that by taking into account all aspects and matters. And, as members will know, the consultation opened on Monday and will run until March. They will also take into account issues like the jury size, the majority required for conviction and the requirement for corroboration, very integrated and important issues as well. They are complex issues, and our Parliament has been here before with corroboration, and no changes ultimately came forward. So this deserves a thorough period of consultation to get it right. And unfortunately, it does mean it will take some time. However, I, for one, would rather do the job well done than rush through and not fit for purpose. Legal professionals, the third sector and those with lived experiences of the system all need time to give a considered opinion, and we cannot reach a decision until we listen to all key stakeholders and have a full understanding of how all the different parts of the system might work together. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government are committed to ensuring that victims' rights are at the heart of delivering justice in Scotland. The programme for Government prioritises to put the voices of victims and a trauma-informed approach at the heart of Scottish justice. This year, the Scottish Government will unveil a new funding programme which will ensure there is practical and emotional support in place for victims, survivors and witnesses of crime across Scotland. We will also introduce a new framework specific to the justice system, which will give staff the knowledge and skills they need to understand and adopt a trauma-informed approach, helping them to support victims more compassionately. And having worked in the social work justice sector myself, I think this is something that will really overhaul the system and give victims the support they need. I think most importantly, we will also prepare for the necessary legislative process to appoint a victims commissioner. The commissioner will provide an independent voice for victims, champion their views and encourage policymakers and criminal justice agencies to put victims' rights at the heart of justice. We also know that serious consideration will be given to the recommendations of the Dorrien Review, including the introduction of specialist courts and allowing victims to pre-record their evidence. Aspects of this that the Cabinet Secretary himself talked about at the Justice Committee this morning, which I think was a very, very useful session, and I want to thank him for that. This, I feel, very much builds upon important work in the last session that was done, such as around the Vulnerable Witnesses Bill, which was passed. I think it is clear, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, that we are committed to supporting victims, and the three-verdict legal system is undergoing the review that has been called for and is needed. If something can be done that will make the system fairer and more trauma-informed for complainers and victims, then we will do it, but we will not make matters worse, and so we must do this with careful consideration, and I believe this is exactly what this government will do. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I begin, I refer members to my register of interests. The Scottish legal system takes great pride in its reputation, specifically elements that mark it out as different, the not proven verdict and corroboration. These are held up as iconic elements of a historic system and, according to some, are worthy of protection. Not everyone shares this view, however, and it is often those that the system hears from least but should be designed to protect that argue most ardently for reform. That is exactly the case with the not proven verdict. This historical accident remains in our system as a legacy from when juries adjudicated specific facts rather than assessing guilt or innocence. And yet, organisations that support the complainers, victims and survivors of crime, and the victims and survivors themselves, have been telling us for years that not proven is deeply problematic. This not proven verdict has reached disproportionately in rape and attempted rape cases. In 2019-20, the overall incidence of not proven verdicts was 1%. Among jury trials, 5%. But in rape or attempted rape trials, it was 25%. And we know that it accounts for nearly double the number of acquittals for rape and attempted rape cases compared to acquittals for all crimes and offences. So why does this matter? The not proven verdict has the exact same impact as a not guilty verdict and can be as distressing, if not more so, for the complainer as a not guilty verdict. There are no legal consequences for the accused of a not proven verdict. It has reached disproportionately in serious sexual offence cases. Given the already woeful prosecution rates for such offences, that means that it is women who tend to bear the brunt of such verdicts. There is clear evidence from independent jury research that shows jurors do not understand it and don't really know what it means. It is not defined in law or practice, nor is the difference between it and not guilty. Indeed, the appeal court has instructed judges not to attempt to describe the difference, calling it highly dangerous to do so. This means it is not only not well understood, but because of poor understanding, is reached inconsistently. And when it is reached, there is a clear mismatch between the messages sent by the jury in reaching this verdict and those received by the public. No one knows what it means. In 2019-20, 43% of solemn sexual offence cases led to convictions, compared to 77% of solemn prosecutions as a whole. This says much about society's attitudes to victims and survivors of rape, and it is clearly bound up in patriarchal structures that victim blame and do not believe women. But whatever the reasons, low conviction rates for rape indicate an unwillingness to convict. There is evidence to suggest that the not proven verdict is reached as a soft acquittal option. There are real worries that the existence of this verdict gives juries in rape trials an easy out and contributes to guilty people walking free. Not proven enables rape myths and the stigma attached to it to be propagated, and complainers in such cases say that it does nothing to encourage them or others who have suffered gender-based violence to have faith in the criminal justice system. None of this helps complainers, victims and survivors of sexual crimes, and none of this aids the work that we must do to ensure that our justice system is able to tackle the imbalances and inequalities of power in our society. Presiding Officer, I want to close with the words of a survivor who has campaigned passionately for the abolition of not proven. Get rid of the not proven verdict, as it's degrading, heartbreaking, and they all laugh in our face because in my eyes, they got away with their disgusting acts of abuse. And as always told me, no one will believe you if you tell. That is exactly how it feels.
Thank you. I call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The not proven verdict, perhaps the most unique aspect of Scots criminal law, has split opinion through the centuries. It's easy to see how controversial the verdict is from its many names. The convenient verdict, the sophisticated or ungracious verdict, or the second-class acquittal that is characterised as both ambiguous and indefensible. Sir Walter Scott, perhaps Scotland's most famous lawyer, even referred to it as that bastard verdict, adding, "One who is not proved guilty is innocent in the eyes of the law." This is a view that many share. It is the reason we are gathered here today, just as elected representatives and judges in Scotland have gathered to debate this issue, not just in 2016, but in 1994, 1975, and even before 1728, when a Scottish jury declared its ancient right to pass a judgment of not guilty rather than use the term not proven. A historical accident is how some have described the verdict. Numerous legal academics support this theory, noting that there is no set form to verdicts used by early juries, with a wide range of terms being used instead. Not proven was just one verdict amongst many, with those found guilty sometimes being found felt, culpable and convict, while those who were not guilty were clean, innocent and acquit. Presiding Officer, not proven is the product of a messy legal system, a wrinkle from a different time that has never quite been ironed out, and one that is now having severe repercussions in the 21st century. We hear it from all corners of society, from the families of murder victims, victims of domestic abuse, or from women's rights organisations. Rape Crisis Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid and the Scottish Women's Rights Centre have all campaigned to abolish the verdict. Not proven is not justice, they say, and they're right. The role of not proven in cases of sexual violence is evidence enough for the verdict's removal. Rape convictions are much lower than for any other crime. The removal of the not proven verdict would strengthen the law here and introduce an element of black and white to these cases, rather than the unsatisfying ambiguity that a not proven decision leaves behind. What's more, if the verdict was a satisfactory way to resolve cases, then we would be seeing it used in courts around the world. Instead, we find that only 0.06% of the world's population live in jurisdictions that use this verdict. That should say it all. Presiding Officer, it's time for a little housekeeping in the Scottish legal system. We've heard many statistics, case studies and arguments made by my Scottish Conservative colleagues calling for the abolition of this ancient verdict. They're right, as history has also shown time and time again. Not proven has no place in our legal system today. No more than a horse and cart has on the motorway, in my last sentence. So I urge you to support the motion today and abolish this out-of-date verdict for good. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Colette Stevenson, the last speaker in the open debate.
Presiding Officer, everyone in this chamber is agreed that we need a fair, transparent justice system that works for the victims of crime, and in particular, one that supports survivors of gender-based violence, rape and attempted rape and domestic abuse. On Monday, as the Tories know, the Cabinet Secretary confirmed the launch of a consultation on the three-verdict system and related reforms. It's right that people, including survivors, get to have their say, and I would encourage as many people as possible to participate. I know the Scottish Government will listen carefully to survivors, the third sector, the police, legal experts and other stakeholders on this matter and take a reasoned position. Reform of the justice system is a complex matter. There are many facets to ensuring better outcomes for survivors of crime. Abolition of the not proven verdict on its own doesn't necessarily guarantee this. The mock jury evidence shows this, and it's also been highlighted by the Law Society of Scotland. In terms of tackling these crimes, right now, The focus must be on supporting all sectors of the criminal justice system to function well and recover from the effects of the pandemic. The Scottish Government will increase investment in justice by 7% next year, and that is very welcome. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service budget will be increased, and an investment of £26.5 million through the Justice Recovery Fund will help tackle the backlog of cases. This is paramount so that many people, particularly survivors of sexual crime, can get justice. Rightly, the Scottish Government's work is wide-ranging and much of its approach focuses on prevention. Over the SNP's term in office, crime, including violent crime, has fallen and most people do not experience it. The Scottish Government is continuing its work to reduce crime, build safe communities and put victims and witnesses at the heart of the justice system. That key aim of continuing to cut crime and re-offending, as has been done, means there are fewer victims. However, until the day comes when where we have eradicated crime, particularly those we are considering today, such as domestic abuse and sexual crimes, then it is incumbent on government to ensure the justice system is fair and transparent and that it meets the needs of modern society. Rape Crisis Scotland has published work showing that most rape and attempted rape cases don't even make it to court. For those cases that do, only 43% ended in a conviction in 2019-20. Around a quarter of prosecuted cases resulted in a not proven verdict. Along with colleagues on the Criminal Justice Committee, I have heard firsthand from survivors of gender-based violence about their views and experience of the justice system. It is essential that we listen to them. I also welcome the Lord Justice Clerk's review on the management of sexual offence cases. And regardless of the consultation results on the three verdict system, I think that a specialist trauma-informed court for sexual offences could work well. To conclude, Presiding Officer, we all want a fair justice system that supports victims and witnesses. Let's encourage people to engage with the consultation on justice reform so that any reforms are done for a purpose and that our justice system meets the needs of 21st century Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to winding up speeches and I call on Rhoda Grant. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's been a very interesting debate. But this issue has been debated for a long time, and it's a bit disappointing today that the Government are therefore hiding behind the need for further consultation rather than providing leadership on this issue. We support the abolition of the not proven verdict, but we also recognise that it's not a resolution in itself. The victims will still be let down if a not proven verdict simply becomes a not guilty verdict. We need a justice system that protects victims and brings perpetrators to justice. We see an increase in sexual violence, and Katie Clark and others talked about the fact that 70% of the workload of the High Court is sexual offences. Is this because we're not prosecuting those offences properly and offenders get off? And why is there an attitude in society that this type of offence is on the increase? Is it because young people are getting their sex education for pornography, or that we live in a society where attitudes to sexual violence are strange, where victim blaming is common?
Sorry, Ms. Grant, could you just give me a second, please? Can I ask colleagues, please, to desist from conversations across the chamber? Thank you. Ms. Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Katie Clark said our justice system works for male perpetrators rather than female victims. And as a society, we have to share the blame for that. Martin Whitfield talked about 43% of rape and attempted rape cases reaching convictions and compared that to 88% of other cases. That's a huge gap. It shows us what is wrong with our system. It's a wake-up call to all of us that the system is not working. And he also spoke about the large number of cases that actually never reached a court. Katie Clark talked about the impact of the backlog in our courts on victims. And again, we see that 70% of High Court cases are to do with sexual violence. That is having a disproportionate impact on women. And it's very difficult for those victims because they're waiting for an outcome and that outcome is not coming. And then when they reach court, 44% of rape or attempted rape cases end up in a not proven verdict compared with 20% of others. Another wake-up call for us. Surely we can all see the difference. Katie Clark also talked about Lady Dorian's review, and she talked about training for juries, and I think that is right because Martin Whitfield talked about how easy it was for juries to use this as an opt-out, and Maggie Chapman talked about the lack of understanding that juries have about this verdict and prosecutors being discouraged from actually explaining it to them. And we all know that cases are really difficult. Liam MacArthur talked about cross-examination in sexual violence cases, how it re-traumatises victims, it belittles victims, it actually trashes their characters, making them out to be liars because those cases come down from one person's word against another. So we need to make a justice system safe for victims, and there, if we do that, we'll get greater reporting. The justice system is there for should be there for victims and not just for the sake of the justice system itself. We support the motion, but we also believe that we need to make a big difference to the justice system so that trials are conducted properly. We need a step change in how they are prosecuted. It's wrong that trials re-traumatise victims rather than promote closure. Presiding Officer, we all have a duty to put that right.
Thank you. I now call on Keith Brown, up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I said in my opening words, the Scottish legal system has evolved substantially over the centuries, and it's vital that we ensure the justice system develops in response to new evidence, and it's in line with the values of the people of Scotland, a point I think made by other speakers. I would just say I think Liam MacArthur's contribution was measured and informative, and I would certainly support it. And also, for his benefit, to say that in relation to the issue of anonymity, we intend to proceed in relation to that, as we laid out in a manifesto. It's complicated, of course, by making sure you can cope with the online age, but we intend to address that issue. In the 21st century, our justice system has to be person-centred, transparent, accessible and fair to all, satisfying public confidence by reflecting the needs and views of those who directly participate in it and whose lives are impacted by it. And it's for that reason we think the consultation is the right way to go. I am surprised. I didn't realise the Labour Party's position was to say that the consultation was an exercise that we could hide behind. I think it's a genuine attempt to engage with those that are most directly affected by this. And I would certainly disagree with the Tory position that this is... Well, first of all, Jamie Green said this is one of the biggest changes in Scots law that would take place if we were to agree this, and I agree with that. It is not a wrinkle to be ironed out, and neither is it a piece of housekeeping. It's a very serious piece of reform to the justice system, if that's what we agree to do. I'll take Liam MacArthur, yeah.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much. I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary said earlier. I think it may be helpful, but the consultation, I believe, is the right approach to take. But a commitment from the government to bring forward legislative changes within the course of this session of Parliament, I think, would offer some reassurance that this won't drift into a future session of Parliament and provide some of that reassurance that I think all members are seeking to get here.
Cabinet Secretary.
What I say to Liam MacArthur is that I think, and I said this to the Justice Committee this morning, which I appreciate he wouldn't have heard, is that Lady Dorian's numerous recommendations which are made also require legislative change. And so once we've been through this consultation process and also we get a view on the interrelated matters, jury size and so on, then it's possible to move forward at that stage with hopefully a suite of measures which will address some of the points which have been addressed. But we have a commitment, just to go back to the previous point, to address the issue of anonymity and on its own merits. So I can't. I'm the only person that's taken any interventions in this debate, and I don't have much time left, so apologies for that. Of course, these are not straightforward matters, so surely it's right that we engage properly on these complex matters before we take decisive action. And how else could we ensure such reforms are effective and free from unintended consequences without having a full consultation process? I listened with some disbelief to the Conservatives, who proclaim themselves to be the party of law and order, suggesting today that we disregard the views of the legal profession when it comes to what is a very complex legal matter. In September 2021, in a written submission to the Criminal Justice Committee, the Faculty of Advocates set out their opposition to the removal of the not proven verdict, which in their view is a safeguard which is necessary in a system with a simple majority. If not proven was to be removed, they argued that this should not be done in isolation and discussion consultation would be required. That was the view of the Faculty of Advocates, to identify the changes in our criminal justice system that would be required in order to accommodate such a significant change, not a tidying up, not a wrinkle, without jeopardising reliable justice. Now, I've been clear that I have serious concerns with the not proven verdict, and just because the consultation is rightly an holistic one, that is not to say that one aspect, of course, it could be reformed without corresponding changes to the others. I don't think it should be reformed without considering what possible changes might have to take place. Surely, regardless of what reform, if any, is ultimately taken forward, the opinions of the legal profession and those most directly impacted by this verdict should be listened to. And of course, the right place to do that listening is in a full consultation exercise, which is exactly what we are doing. And of course, it's not just the views of the legal sector we should be listening to. We will continue to take the open and consultative approach that we have used to date, seeking to capture the views of a broad range of stakeholders, including the third sector, people with lived experience of the justice system, including, of course, those that the Justice Committee themselves have listened to, some of whom I have listened to and spoken with directly myself, and that includes survivors and victims of crime. And some of the discussions that have most shaped my thinking have been with survivors, and I'm eager to hear their views on the consultation. As I noted initially, we must be mindful that the not proven verdict affects all cases, not just sexual offences. So any reform must take a holistic view that considers potential impacts across the piece. And although many of us value the distinctive features of the existing Scottish criminal justice system, I don't believe that in itself is a bad thing, but I do take Maggie Chapman's point about the fact that they cannot just be venerated for their own sake and we should make sure the system reflects our current values. That should not prevent us from asking questions or seeking new perspectives to drive further improvements, particularly those with direct experience of the criminal justice system, to ensure the system remains relevant. The incredible efforts of justice partners, third sector organisations, judiciary and the defence community during the COVID pandemic has made clear there is still tremendous potential for the justice system to benefit from collaboration, innovation and new ways of working. I trust that many of these stakeholders will contribute their thoughtful and considered opinions.
If the Cabinet Secretary could wind up, please.
I look forward to considering the full range of views received, and I want to listen to what the consultees tell us before we weigh all the evidence and reach a conclusion. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Russell Finlay to wind up the debate. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In 1846, the British Parliament voted to repeal the Corn Laws. The Liberty Bell cracked while being rung for George Washington's birthday, and the planet of Neptune was discovered. It was also the year in which the debate about Scotland's not proven verdict began in earnest. Lord Coburn, a former Solicitor General, wrote that not proven was incompatible with the presumption of innocence, and also stigmatised and accused. He added, and I quote, that it tempts jurymen not to look steadily at the evidence and to give it its correct result, but to speculate about the possibility of soothing their consciousness or their feelings by neither convicting nor acquitting, but steering between the two. While His Lordship's language may sound dated, the essential arguments against not proven have barely changed in the 175 years since. I'm firmly of the view that not proven, as Sharon Dowie rightly pointed out, is known by some as the bastard verdict, is long past its sell-by date. It not only serves no legitimate purpose, but actually corrodes public faith in justice. It is commendable that my party and my colleague Jamie Green are leading this debate and seeking to abolish not proven as part of a broader range of measures in our proposed victims law. Entrusting jurors with the clearly understood two-verdict choice between guilty and not guilty would bring Scotland into line with virtually every other comparable criminal justice system around the world. A trio of professors, James Chalmers and Fiona Leverick of Glasgow University and Vanessa Munro of Warwick University, have produced significant research on this subject. In a submission to the Parliament's Criminal Justice Committee, which I would recommend to all members, they explained that not proven is a historical accident and not a matter of conscious design. As Jamie Green has already said, they also said the stigma that attaches to the verdict operates by a nudge and a wink, carrying a meaning which no one is willing to articulate and which, if they were prepared to articulate, would be seen as unjust and improper. They also point to evidence of jurors using not proven as a compromise and in order to bring deliberations to an end rather than engaging in more rigorous discussions. We're forbidden from knowing what goes on behind the jury room's door, but the perception of not proven being a convenient cop-out has often been suspected. Yesterday I spoke with Maria Kearney, whose 24-year-old son Craig was killed in East Kilbride in 2017. Craig's family, already suffering unimaginable grief, were further devastated when the accused walked free, the murder charge not proven. The Kearney family will never know, but just as Lord Coburn expressed, they worry about how this was arrived at. One of the benefits of closing the debate on my colleague Jamie Green's motion is having the benefit of hearing contributions from across the chamber. Maggie Chapman, Katie Clark, Megan Gallagher and the late substitute Martin Whitfield have already spoken about how the verdict is disproportionately used in sexual crimes, particularly those of rape, for which the conviction rate remains shockingly low. I commend the work of Rape Crisis Scotland and its End Not Proven campaign. Crime victims have long campaigned for Not Proven to be scrapped. It has caused and will continue to cause immeasurable harm. Presiding Officer, 9 years ago, in 2012, an SNP Justice Secretary launched a consultation on scrapping Not Proven. A year later, in 2013, he kicked it further into the long grass with a two-year review. This concluded with a second SNP Justice Secretary opting to keep Not Proven while saying that yet more research was needed. Fast forward to 2019. Yes, I will.
Cabinet Secretary.
I wonder if the member would want to comment on the decades of Tory rule when nothing was done about this. And also, just to clarify, if he would, the Tory position, which is to scrap Not Proven, I understand, to scrap the consultation and immediately move to legislation without listening to the people that are most involved in this or to the victims and other organisations. Is that the Tory position?
Russell Findlay.
Thank you. I don't know about what purpose any whataboutery will serve, but in respect of the timeline, as I was trying to explain to you about what your predecessors have been doing, in 2019, a study revealed that not proven may push jurors towards acquittal before they'd even discussed the evidence. A third SNP Justice Secretary said it was time to consider not proven, subject, of course, to yet further consultation. During this year's election campaign, that Justice Secretary then pledged to consult in abolishing not proven. I'm sure the rape victims and murder victims' families were as deflated and indeed cynical as I was on Monday when a fourth SNP Justice Secretary, Keith Brown, revealed that he is to launch yet another talking shop about not proven. Mr Brown, we've been talking about it for 175 years. Your government's been talking about it for 10 years. We know the arguments, we know what is right, the time for dithering and talking is over. I disagree with Mr MacArthur that we are jumping the gun, and I also disagree with Mr McGregor's assertion of politicking. I think it's appropriate to save the last word for Maria Kearney, who said, "No one wants to know. There's no justice. We're worried that the government is going to just keep dragging it out and nothing's going to get done about it."
Thank you. That concludes the debate on ending the not proven verdict. And I'd just like to take an opportunity to before we move on to the next item of business, to provide members with a further update in relation to the issues experienced earlier today that impacted on blue jeans. There was a worldwide outage of Amazon Web Services that resulted in the loss of the blue jeans service. Unfortunately, and members will appreciate these circumstances were beyond our control, we weren't able to confirm that stable access could be restored to allow those members who would have been speaking remotely today to take part in this afternoon's debates and other items. So my apologies to those members who were unable to do so. Those members were Willie Rennie, Julian Martin, Pauline McNeill, Rona Mackay and Claire Baker. And I understand that Ariane Burgess and Carol Mockin will be unable to take part in members' business for the same reason this evening. Now, business managers have agreed that decisions due to be taken today will be deferred to a future point, and I'll shortly invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move a motion without notice seeking the Parliament's agreement to this, and I will discuss with business managers when we will take any deferred decisions. And members will be updated ahead of business tomorrow to confirm whether online services have been restored that will allow for normal participation remotely. So, and without further ado, I'd like to invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.5 that the decisions due to be taken today be deferred to a future meeting.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Oh, well,
thank you. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move on to members' business. There'll be a short pause.